As the Insider exclusive investigative news team travels across America producing the Justice in America Network TV series, we invite you to join us as we uncover real stories about the issues that promote justice and fairness for injured people, safeguards victims' rights, and the opportunity to help guide the hands of justice, especially when people's lives have been destroyed, families ruined, dreams lost, or widespread societal change and reform are needed. These true stories about real ordinary people, their real lives, always up close and personal, and always unfiltered stories of unimaginable pain, suffering, and great wrongs, but also of courage and faith and the dauntlessness of the human spirit. These stories are also about the trial lawyers who helped these ordinary people navigate a very complex legal system to get justice as they faced extreme life-altering adversities, and how the government and big business with their million-dollar PR campaigns are slowly eroding our rights to seek justice and making an end run around the civil justice system. Our TV stories show relief and vindication for shattered lives and seemingly lost souls. The compassion, warmth, love, and determination of the human spirit found within these shows are neither imagined nor contrived. They are truly personal crusades and telling journeys of what it means to seek justice in the American courtroom. In this Insider exclusive network TV special, Justice in America, The Truths and Myths of Tort Reform, we visit with John Morgan at John S. Morgan Law Firm as he takes us inside today's legal system, examining lawyers' strategies, clients' thoughts, and in vivid detail, showing you the often heartbreaking stories of these clients, dramatically demonstrating what motivates trial lawyers to fight for their clients' causes. Some of these same trial lawyers have been in the crosshairs of attacks by so-called tort reform advocates for the past 30 years. These attacks are not new. Now, a lot of you have heard and read about tort reform, but really don't understand how or what it really means, or how it affects us negatively every time we walk into the courtroom. So in this special Network TV Insider exclusive documentary, Justice in America, The Truths and Myths of Tort Reform, we will show you how tort reform is making justice more and more difficult for the average American. And we're not going to do it just by words or fancy language, but by inviting you along to meet our guests in small and big towns across America who've had the unfortunate bad luck to be severely injured or victimized by big businesses, the government, or law enforcement. These victims could be you or me one day, and if you are so unlucky, you will quickly find out that justice in America is a hard-won battle where very few companies and individuals do the right thing, and you need trial lawyers who wage a battle with their own financial resources to get their clients justice. But before we get started, just for the record, let's define what the heck tort reform means in simple language. Tort is a legal term describing the system of compensation used by the courts to assign remedies, awards, and damages for harm done by one party to another, be it to their person, property, or other protected interest. Tort law defines what constitutes a legal injury and establishes liability. It's the civil court's answer to criminal law. Tort reform, then, is the political term for the controversial issue of reducing tort litigation, awards, damages, and/or compensation. Now, tort reform isn't one single idea or law. Instead, it's a group of ideas and laws designed to change the way our civil justice system works. While each tort reform law is different, they all share one or more of the following goals: to make it more difficult for injured people to file a lawsuit, to make it more difficult for injured people to obtain a jury trial, and to put limits on the amount of money injured people receive in a lawsuit. Keep in mind that throughout history, our civil justice system has kept Americans safe by allowing them a fair chance to receive justice when they are injured by the negligence of others, even when it means taking on the most powerful corporations. When corporations and their CEOs act irresponsibly by cutting corners on safety, producing unsafe products, polluting our environment, or swindling their employees and shareholders, the last resort to hold them accountable is in our courts. The legal system provides justice to those injured by deliberate misconduct and deters future misconduct by holding wrongdoers accountable. Here's just a quick review of a few Justice in America Network TV show segments of these real case stories of ordinary people, their real lives, and their trial lawyers who've helped these ordinary folks navigate a very complex legal system to get justice as they faced extreme life-altering adversities. Real cases that promote justice and fairness for injured people, safeguards victims' rights and the opportunity to help guide the hands of justice, especially when people's lives have been destroyed, families ruined, dreams lost, or widespread societal change and reform are needed, and how the government and big business are slowly eroding our rights to seek justice, making an end run around the civil justice system and calling it tort reform.
And because of one negligent moment, it has become a painful and needless tragedy.
The state of Louisiana's medical malpractice laws are full of traps, and how the healthcare and insurance industries are far more protected than anywhere else. In Sharon Boxey's case, you will see how her doctors malpositioned her head and neck during surgery that substantially reduced blood flow through the carotid arteries to her brain, causing massive brain damage, which went undetected during surgery and rendered her a total quadriplegic.
So far in 34 years, no one has come close to having a Supreme Court decision finding that the cap or the act was unconstitutional.
We are going to show right now a day in the life of Sharon Boxey and what these doctors did to her. And you're quite familiar with this video that we have on the screen right now. Tell us a little bit about her daily activities.
Well, her daily activities are markedly reduced. Her sister and her family have been incredibly supportive, caring for her and doing the physical therapy and the other steps that are necessary to keep her alive and functioning as well as she possibly could. But basically in the course of a day, because of her limitations, she can do virtually nothing other than watch TV, talk with people who come over, maybe read a little bit, but even read, I mean, she can't turn a page. She has no movement in her hands or arms or legs.
Don mentioned to me, Sharon, that one of the reasons that you have so much drive and fortitude is you want to show others that the laws in the state of Louisiana aren't the best laws in the world concerning medical malpractice cases, right?
It does, Craig.
We'll be right back.
On July 26, 2003, at approximately 3:45 in the afternoon, Christopher Allison and his family were driving back to Pocatello, Idaho, from their vacation in Washington. Suddenly and unexpectedly, their vehicle was struck by another driver from the rear, jackknifing their camper and overturning their Ford Expedition, crushing and killing Christopher and injuring the rest of the Allison family. Today, the Insider Exclusive will show you how the Allison's lawyers, Robert Krause and Emily Rankin of the Spence Law Firm, took on Ford Motor Company and successfully sued them for the defective product design of the door latch and component system and other defects, and got justice for the Allison family.
My name's Jeffrey Scott Hornoff, and I'm a police officer. I was convicted of first-degree murder and sentenced to life in prison. Every step of the judicial system failed me and my family. And if not for the guilt and remorse of the true killer, I'd still be in prison.
She died. I killed her.
Why would you not want to ensure that California stops putting innocent people in prison? It's a very good question.
I was locked up when I was 20 years old, just turned 20 years old. I'm 42 now, so I've been in a little over 22 years.
It was hard for my father to explain to me. I got convicted of raping somebody, but Daddy didn't do it. So it was like, how you not do it, Daddy, if you've been in here for all these years now?
Everything in your life is wonderful, and then one day, somebody comes up and tells a lie on you, and you end up in jail. What's different is he knows fear doesn't exist.
When they told me rape, robbery, possession of instrument, crime, gun, conspiracy, all these, I'm like, my God, you know, this is almost like 100 years in jail for something you didn't do, and I'm really scared.
I was in shock because I got found guilty.
I looked him right in the face, and I said, you and I both know I didn't kill anyone. And he couldn't look me in the eye.
He sentenced me to all that time, and I didn't know what to expect in prison. You know, I expected to be beaten, be raped. I expected to die in prison.
The government has failed the exonerated.
It's finally over. It's been 19 years. What now?
Go home.
Thank you.
Dr. William J. Irwin failed to comply with the appropriate standard of care for an OBGYN in the year 2007. And as a result, Rebecca Gatti, a newborn baby, suffered severe brain damage, which is lifelong and irreversible. Those brutally frank words were how the Louisiana Medical Review Board explained to Ryan and Susan Gatti, the parents of their new baby girl, Rebecca, why Rebecca had suffered irreversible brain damage due to the incompetence of Dr. Irwin, and now will require round-the-clock care for the rest of her life with no chance whatsoever for improvement. Today, the Insider Exclusive will take you behind the headlines of this real-life couple, Ryan and Susan Gatti, who entrusted their child's health and welfare to this grossly incompetent doctor. Following is a TV commercial for American Family Insurance.
Since the dawn of time, people have needed people. The personal connection, the shoulder to lean on. That is our role. To deliver more than just a policy on a piece of paper, to deliver peace of mind. Because we are family. American Family. And like family, we grow stronger each day with the constant promise to always be fair, helpful, and caring. Doing whatever we can to make things easier. Striving to keep our promises. This is what we do for our clients. We get to know them like family. Because that's who we are. American Family Insurance.
But today, the Insider Exclusive presents a true, really tragic story, one that American Family Insurance doesn't want you to know. One hot Missouri summer day, Galen Ritchie's sister, Brenda, called her insurance company, American Family, and her agent, Catherine Philip Leitz, telling her that a 1,400-pound tree limb, nearly half the tree, had fallen on Brenda's house. She called three times that week, and on three separate occasions, American Family refused to pay to have this 1,400-pound limb removed. If you don't care about people, you couldn't do this job. Sounds real good, doesn't it? Only problem is, Anthem Blue Cross really doesn't mean what they say. Ask Bob Daringer, widow of Esther Daringer. 49-year-old Esther beat breast cancer until it metastasized to her brain. Ohio State University physician Dr. Herbert Newton, her physician, had successfully treated cancer like Esther's through intra-arterial chemotherapy. Her husband's health insurer, Anthem Blue Cross, paid for three of the 12 scheduled treatments. Bob and Esther first learned that the fourth treatment was being denied the day before it was given. The insurance company had approved the first three of the 12 treatments, but then refused further payment, declaring the procedure experimental. Cigarette smoking is the leading cause of preventable death in the United States. It causes serious illness among an estimated 8.6 million persons. It costs $167 billion in annual health-related losses, and it kills approximately 438,000 people each year. Worldwide, smoking kills nearly 5 million people annually.
To stand here today with dedicated colleagues from within the Department of Justice as well as beyond it to announce a historic settlement with Pfizer Incorporated. In a combination civil and criminal settlement, Pfizer has agreed to pay $2.3 billion, the largest health care fraud settlement in the history of the Department of Justice.
You now know that exposure to asbestos products caused this.
Yes.
Not only in the Navy, but also working as a custodian at the school.
Yes.
You're on national TV now. What do you have to say to the manufacturers that created these products?
Well, they knew years ago, and they should have started much earlier in the process of eliminating the asbestos from all their products. Mm-hmm.
They chose not to, you know that.
They chose not to. Most of the major companies, some that were litigated against, filed bankruptcy and then turned around and regrouped, and they were doing the exact same thing.
They're going strong.
Using the same products.
Yeah, they have a total disregard for human life, don't
mm-hmm.
they?
They too.
Correctional officer, and I chose that field because I wanted to make a positive impact on inmates. I view my prognosis as good. I keep responding to treatment, and I was just talking to my sister yesterday because there's times where you get down and you think, oh, you know, you just want to give up.
Cannot operate with one hand.
Dr. Anthony Sterling is an orthopedic surgeon who can no longer take care of his patients. He's been disabled ever since 1998 when he had surgery to remove a bone spur pressing on his spinal cord. the surgery did not turn out well. The worst thing that could happen to a surgeon happened to Dr. Sterling. During the surgery, he suffered a terrible injury that rendered his left arm completely paralyzed, and it remains paralyzed to this day, trapped in an ugly brace. So the man who routinely performed about 500 surgeries a year and expected to continue helping patients for another 15 years can no longer enter an operating room.
Stands, leaving only enough time, 3 seconds, for Clay Rush to possibly kick the game winner. Rush has made field goals of 20 and 26 yards, missed from 41. This one will be from 20 yards to win the Arena Bowl.
When I think about football when I was playing, I like the challenges that it presented itself. You had to be physically fit. You had to be mentally fit. What's unique about arena football? I miss the fans. It's a close-knit group. We consider us as a family. I've had over 30 procedures done with the head and neck. I've been on 90 different medications. I don't know what it's like not to have a headache.
For many of the nearly 50,000 9/11 first responders, the wounds of the Twin Tower attacks are far from healing. These rescue workers continue to struggle with respiratory illness, depression, and post-traumatic stress disorder, and many of them may be at increased risk for developing a number of cancers. Because they and their fellow rescue workers were picking through rubble littered with asbestos, mercury, crushed fluorescent light bulbs, and other known toxins, and they were outfitted with only their normal uniform to protect them from potential contaminants. When hundreds of victims and their families were left struggling with impending health problems and emotional instabilities after the World Trade Center attacks, the Uniformed Firefighters Association of Greater New York selected one law firm, Sullivan, Papaine, Block, McGrath, and Canavo, their friends and trusted legal advisors for the past 20 years, to come to their rescue. Because sometimes even first responders need to be saved.
I was promised a better life, far away from my home. I used to have a family.
Now, I must pay for my family's debts.
I sleep with many men every day. They make me kill for a war.
Work many long hours.
trapped, beaten,
scared,
locked in the dark.
With no way out.
I want to go home.
I want my freedom.
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 Across the U.S., people are rising up against fracking for natural gas. A deadly threat to our homes and our lives is looming on the horizon. It is a new technique of gas oil extraction. It is known by various names. For example, the oil and gas industry says it isn't new. The industry says it's safe. But the industry is lying. The vertical gas wells are a completely different technology. The new technique of deep horizontal fracking destroys drinking water supplies, pollutes our air and our environments, and will continue to do so for possibly hundreds of years as the well casings inevitably fail and disposal sites inevitably leak. In this insider-exclusive investigative TV series, new documentary, Fracking, Dangerous Contamination, Bob and Lisa Parr's story. Our news team found that in any area where fracking operations have happened, the local people have been outraged by the catastrophic damage to land, water supplies, air quality, animal and human health. Local economies have been destroyed, property values have fallen drastically, up to 90%. And one of those areas is in Wise County, Texas, where the Barnett Shale is located. This is where we begin our story with Bob and Lisa Parr at their ranch and with their lawyer, Brad Gildy of the Gildy Law Firm.
Question. You were here in July, and you said that you were you commended Dodd-Frank for providing a blueprint to get rid of too big to fail. We've now understood this problem for nearly 5 years. So when are we going to get rid of too big to fail?
Well, some of the, you know, as we've been discussing, you know, some of these rules take time to develop. The Orderly Liquidation Authority, I think we made a lot of progress on that. We've got the living wills. I think we're moving in the right direction. If additional steps are needed, then Congress obviously can discuss those, but we do have a plan, and I think it's moving in the right direction.
Any idea about when we're going to arrive in the right direction?
It's not a 0-1 kind of thing. It's over time.
The concern that you have raised is one that I frankly share, and I'm not talking about HSBC now, because that maybe that not be appropriate, but I am concerned that the size of some of these institutions becomes so large that it does become difficult for us to prosecute them when we are hit with indications that if you do prosecute, if you do bring a criminal charge, it will have a negative impact on the national economy, perhaps even the world economy. And I think that is a function of the fact that some of these institutions have become too large.
Tell me a little bit about the last few times you've taken the biggest financial institutions on Wall Street all the way to a trial. Anybody? I appreciate that you say you don't have to bring them to trial. My question is, when did you bring them to trial?
We have not had to do it as a practical matter to achieve our supervisory goals.
Can you identify when you last took the Wall Street banks to trial?
I will have to get back to you with the specific information.
the last thing that we as Americans would remotely suspect is that the greatest engineering firm in the world, so named because they were able to build a Panama Canal when no one else could, the greatest engineering firm in the world caused the flooding of this city, not Hurricane Katrina, the United States Army Corps of Engineers.
These are just a few of the real Americans who have dealt with our legal system that is gradually eroding in favor of big business and the government because of tort reform legislation. And this is why we all need to protect a legal system that is designed to protect us and not one that protects corporate business or the government over the common everyday American. John Morgan, our featured lawyer, has earned the highest respect from citizens and lawyers alike as one of the best trial lawyers in Beaumont, in Texas, and across the nation. His goals, not only to get justice for his clients, but to make sure all Americans have the right to a fair trial, honest cops, impartial prosecutors, and fair judges with no agendas. Because injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. This is the Insider Exclusive, live from Beaumont, Texas. It is my great pleasure to introduce John Morgan to the show. Welcome to the show, John.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Tell our audience a little bit about your firm and what kind of law that you like to practice.
I'm a board-certified trial lawyer. I'm licensed in Texas and Louisiana, and mostly I represent individuals in court.
You like representing the little guy, right?
Actually, I do.
Yeah. Why is that?
I've always seen the practice of law as a way of righting wrongs.
Yeah.
And helping people with real, tangible problems in their lives. And when I can help somebody, I feel good about what I do.
Yeah.
It makes me want to come to work the next day when I know that I'm actually helping people instead of corporations or industries.
Right. The show that we're doing now is a show on the truths and myths of tort reform. And when we're talking about the little guy's getting screwed, isn't he?
Oh. Yes, and I would agree with that.
And it is primarily, as we have seen in this show, as a result of a major PR campaign by corporate America stating that trial lawyers like yourself are filing frivolous lawsuits because they want to get rich. What's wrong with that statement?
Pretty much everything. The reality is if an attorney files a frivolous lawsuit, the attorney faces liability. Monetary liability, possibility of sanctions, and could also lose his or her law license.
And he also loses any respect that the judge may have for him, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Because he came in with a ridiculous lawsuit, correct?
Correct.
And you do it enough times, what happens?
You can be declared a vexatious litigant and lose your ability to actually file cases.
So you lose your license?
You could lose your law license. Okay. That's correct.
Now, what about this? Let's talk about the individual again, and let's talk about these lawsuits and some of the problems that you as a trial lawyer representing them have in today's atmosphere, especially here in Texas and in Beaumont, Texas. Proposition 12, medical malpractice cases. What has happened as a result of so-called, quote-unquote, tort reform in the state of Texas?
Well, let's talk about medical malpractice. I used to maintain an active medical malpractice docket. It wasn't the majority of my practice, but I had at any one time about 10 active cases.
And these are people that were injured by doctors.
Doctors' negligence, that's
correct. Oftentimes because they were negligent or they were incompetent, right?
Yes.
You came in, you were supposed to be treated for an issue on one leg and the doctor amputated the wrong leg or something, correct?
Those types of situations have happened, yes.
What happened after Governor Perry signed into law Proposition 12, which was designed to restrain trial lawyers filing frivolous lawsuits from getting rich? What happened as a result of that?
The real effect is that it's almost impossible to sue a doctor in Texas.
Yeah.
It's very, very difficult to prosecute a medical malpractice claim, virtually impossible. So right now, the medical industry and doctors are the most protected industry in Texas. Mm-hmm. I can also state, and I feel very certain about this, that Texas probably has the most restrictive medical malpractice laws in the country. Mm-hmm. And so basically, doctors who do make mistakes and injure people, often those people who were injured by their negligence have no remedy anymore.
Mm-hmm. So you get injured by a doctor, it's almost impossible to sue him or her, correct?
And that's basically correct. It can be done under extreme circumstances, but it's still very difficult.
So tort reforms kind of shut the door of opportunity for these people to seek legal redress, to get compensation, because they are less than whole now, right?
I've talked to several victims of doctors' negligence. Now, first of all, most doctors do a fine job.
Yeah.
Most surgeons do an excellent job, and I'm friends with many of them.
Right.
But I have had the unfortunate experience of having to tell certain potential clients that, guess what, I can't sue for that. I can't represent you in that anymore since the law changed. You have no remedy.
What about other types of cases like product defect cases? Has tort reform made it more difficult to get justice?
Oh, it's rewritten the product liability law. It's shielded the pharmaceutical industry.
Right.
It's very difficult now to successfully prosecute a product liability case unless you have a national recall on a product.
Mm-hmm.
Absent that, it's very, very difficult to do. And the same with the pharmaceutical industry.
Mm-hmm.
The practical effect is that injured people are not having remedies while it sounds trite, but corporate profits and the profits of the insurance industry are increasing.
Mm-hmm. Now, one of the reasons we came here to get this story is because not only are your clients less able to seek justice because of these restrictions,
yes,
but we also have, in this particular county, Jefferson County, an additional problem, which is an alleged corruption that is happening in Beaumont, correct?
Oh, yes, I can definitely attest to that.
Can you tell us a little bit more about what you know of corrupt practices in the judicial system right here in Beaumont?
Well, I represent Mr. Stephen Hartman, and in his civil rights case, and also defending his criminal case, there has been perjury, witness tampering, judicial corruption, and so far in that case alone, it's implicated judges,
mm-hmm.
the sheriff, the former district attorney's office, numerous sheriff deputies, the highest levels of Jefferson County's government, mm-hmm. and all the way up through the commissioner's court.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you from personal experience that corruption among judges doesn't get the exposure that it needs. People are not aware of the gravity of the problem.
What corruption is that?
A lot of the times the judges will rule for their friends, okay? And basically it comes down to whoever has the most money. Not always, there are some good judges, but when there is a wealthy party or a wealthy attorney, they have an unfair advantage.
Mm-hmm.
I have seen judges tamper with records. I have seen personally witnessed judges ordering court reporters to rewrite transcripts.
All right, let me ask you a question. Are you willing to name these judges on camera?
I certainly can name one.
Okay, who's that?
That's former Judge Lane Walker.
Okay, and what did he do?
Pretty much everything, okay? For example, I have personal experience that he ordered the destruction of a party's trial exhibits to sabotage their appeal.
Mm-hmm.
He has ordered court reporters to rewrite transcripts. He had a habit, he's no longer on the bench, of taking people's cell phones and downloading their personal information.
Taking them how? Right in the public? In the courtroom?
In court, ordering them turned over, or if they...
Anybody in the courtroom?
Pretty much.
Right.
If he didn't give the cell phone, such as Mr. Hartman's cell phone was taken.
Okay.
They would.
What right does he have to take someone's cell phone?
He doesn't. It's unconstitutional and it's a crime.
Mm-hmm.
He's fabricated perjured affidavits.
Mm-hmm.
He's engaged in destruction of evidence. The list goes on.
Mm-hmm.
And currently, the new district attorney in Jefferson County has brought in a public corruption task force.
Right.
And I'm hoping that they investigate these matters and bring some of these people to justice.
When you say brought it in from where?
Well, I'm not part of the district attorney's office, but my understanding from the press announcement is that the Federal Bureau of Investigation and the Texas Rangers, those are the state police,
right,
are part of a task force looking into the judicial corruption in Jefferson County.
Does it extend to more than the judge that you mentioned?
Yes, I believe it does. There are several good, decent judges.
Yeah.
But there are others who I believe engage in corrupt practices, and right, it's not just the judicial system. It's also the sheriff's department in Jefferson County.
Yeah.
Has severe problems in this regard.
In regard to like supporting the judges, even if they're wrong or doing something
and doing possibly criminal acts, such as falsifying arrest reports,
right,
trying to destroy evidence, trying to erase a recording pen with evidence,
mm-hmm,
falsifying search warrant affidavits.
Right.
It's a pretty extensive and horrific list if you look at the amount of corruption involved.
Yeah, corruption in addition to tort reform makes it even tougher for an individual to get justice, right?
Certainly right now, I would agree with that.
So we're on national TV. What do you want America to know, not just about what's going on here in Jefferson County and in Beaumont, Texas, but what do you want them to take away from this show in terms of how tort reform is hurting them?
The American citizens have to realize that they need to take back the justice system.
How do they do that?
Well, they have to get involved.
Okay.
And they have to not believe all the high, glossy, expensive commercials paid for by the insurance industries that say all attorneys are causing all these problems.
They're blaming the trial attorney.
They're blaming the trial lawyers. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, the facts speak differently, by the way.
Absolutely.
You know, like when you talked about medical malpractice, insurance companies were behind that. And insurance companies told the doctors that if the lawsuits on medical malpractice suits declined, then their insurance rates would go down too.
And they did not go down.
And they did not. And I've seen figures where the insurance rates have gone up higher in the state of Texas after Proposition 12, which was tort reform in medical malpractice cases, more so than it has in states where there is no tort reform.
That is correct.
Now, the doctors obviously are not stupid. They went to medical school. I mean, they got a brain, and they probably figured out they've been duped, right? But the problem is the general public is not aware of this. When you go in and try a case, and let's say there's a tort reform issue, like employment cases, Title VII, medical malpractice cases, any type of case where there is a cap, are you surprised that a jury doesn't know that there is a cap on pain and suffering in many of these cases?
You'd be surprised. A lot of them, the juries know that there are a cap.
Yeah.
And when I go in and try a case like Title VII, a medical malpractice, even civil rights, what I have noticed is that the jury panel starts off very hostile to the idea of any lawsuit.
Yeah.
And that normally changes when they become educated as to the facts as we go through jury selection. But there is the citizens are allowing themselves to believe that what occurs in the courthouse is always negative.
Yeah.
And the only way to change that is to get the message to the citizens, it's your rights that are being taken away,
mm-hmm,
and to get them involved.
Do you have anything else to share to educate the people? How can they find out about this? You know, laws are pretty complicated, right?
Law is very complicated, and it's getting more complicated.
Where might they look? Where might they learn more about what they should know about the law and how to change it?
It's a good question. It depends on your location.
Yeah.
The best resource that I could tell the citizens, any county or in Louisiana, any parish that they live in,
right.
there is a bar association.
Right.
Okay. I'm in Jefferson County, has a bar association. Houston is in Harris County Bar Association. I invite them to call the Bar Association, mm-hmm. ask for information about tort reform, ask for information about what are the true facts and statistics.
Yeah.
I think they would find out that fewer than, much less than 1% of the lawsuits filed are actually ever deemed frivolous.
Right.
So the information is there. However, the information requires the citizens to make inquiries.
Mm-hmm.
And they also need to talk to victims who were injured and no longer have remedies.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank you very much for sharing your insight on this. And we certainly hope as a result of this outside investigation here in Beaumont or Jefferson County. Is it both?
It's in both. That's correct. Yes.
It straightens things out here because that makes it even tougher for an individual to get justice, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. And I'm wishing the task force the best, and I'm hoping for the best outcome.
All right. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for the opportunity. I appreciate it very much.
You're welcome, John. Thanks for joining us. You can get more information about our guest and the issues at insiderexclusive.com.